answers you should be giving. Also, if you notice in your delegate kit, there is a bunch of papers, and one of the papers is about diagram which shows cleft lip. So I will like you people to draw the relevant points on that diagram, and so this you can do later on and then submit it to the registration desk, and we will evaluate whether you have done it correctly or not, and then do the marking of the method of lip repair of your choice. It can be Millard or it can be Rinderknecht. Okay, so you know, when may I know who are the postgraduates? Can you just raise your hand so that I can ask? Okay, all right. So when you have a case of cleft lip or palate given to you, what are the questions you are going to ask? So why is age of the mother important here? Just we'll start from this side. Yes, the one in red shirt.
Age at the first issue.
Uh-huh. Why is it important to know that?
Sir, any case of this syndromic child, maybe if it is the age is more, so that can be a syndromic child. Or
yes, yes.
Sir, increased parental age is associated with the increased incidence of cleft lip and palate.
It is not only cleft lip and palate. In general, the congenital anomalies chances are much more. And then any history of drug intake, especially the Ayurvedic medicines. So why I have mentioned this word Ayurvedic medicine? Anybody? Harat?
Generally, they had lead and heavy metals are used.
Yes.
Second thing, they most of the time they give steroids also. And third thing, in management of seizure disorders, they give all these allopathic medicines in the form of Ayurvedic preparations. So yes, these three are the important points.
Yes. And then there is history of any epileptic spells the child is undergoing. What is the relevance of that?
It may be syndromic, other
syndromes associated with the cleft palate, especially tetralogy of palate and other cardiac anomalies can be there. So it could be the manifestation of those disorders.
Yes. And I think the panelists would like to add to that. It is also important that we note down whether there is any history of ear discharge, especially in children who are coming to you late. Later than say 1 year or so, because we all know that in cleft palate there is malfunctioning of the eustachian tubes, and so these patients can have initially serous effusion into the middle ear, and this then leads to a pathology which sets in, and the patients can have eardrum ruptures and then subsequent infections. So you know, this is also very important.
If you talk about this eustachian tube function, cleft palate little in great detail, but that's not covered in our
talk. Yes, you can. Yes.
We must know why ear discharge is important in cleft children, especially cleft palates. This is less likely to occur problem in cleft lips, but in cleft palate it is the problem associated in majority of the children. Now Dr. Ramesh said, especially the children who are coming late, because the problem of middle ear disease or CSOM occurs more in later age, because if it is not repaired, if the child has appeared or has presented earlier, it will repair the palate. Once palate is repaired, it is likely that middle ear disease incidence will come down. Though it has, with evidence, it has not been proved, but in clinical practice we see that if it is repaired early, between 6 to 12 months of age, the incidence of ear discharge comes down. But the question is, why there is a problem of middle ear in cleft palate children? The reason is because of the abnormal muscular attachment of the soft palate muscles, especially the tensor and levator. And between two, more important is the tensor for the function of the ischian tube. In normal situation, the tensor palatii curves around the hook of annulus and forms the aponeurosis and joins with the opposite side of the tensor. While in cleft palate, the tensor does not form the aponeurosis. Once it crosses the hook of annulus, it gets attached to the posterior border of the hard palate on the lateral one-third of the posterior border. So normally the function of the tensor is to move the ischian tube based on the activity of the aponeurosis, which is fixed in the midline. While here there is reversal of the function. It gets fixed to the hard palate there, and the ischian tube does not function properly. When it is supposed to close, it opens. Whenever there is deglutition or the food particle is there in the pharynx, it is supposed to close. And then it is supposed to open when it is static. While when the cleft palate is there, there is a reversal of the function of the tensor, and that's why the ischian tube opens at the wrong time. That is one reason. Second is because of the contamination with the food from the regurgitated food from the oral cavity to nasal cavity, there is direct contamination around the ischian tube opening, so it causes mucosal swelling. And third is the hypertrophic adenoid, which is adjacent to the ischian tube opening. So these three factors cause blockade of the ischian tube and does not allow drainage of the secretion of the middle ear to the nasopharynx, which is normally should occur. The ischian tube function is to equalize the atmospheric pressure to the middle ear cavity, which does not happen if there is a blockade of the ischian tube. And once there is a blockade, then there is collection of the discharge, and it causes all the problems, increased pressure, and then perforation of the tympanic membrane, and it causes the chronic otitis media.
Thank you, Dr. Karun. Yeah, this was an important aspect which we had not discussed in the discussions so far. It is also important to look at the lips, especially if there is presence of some sinuses. So can you tell me which
Vanderbilt
syndrome? So what is the importance of this syndrome?
It's associated with cardiac anomalies.
Yes, it can be associated with cardiac anomalies. And then if you leave these sinuses without addressing their problem, then subsequently they can be a source of not only unsightly appearance, it can also lead to, you know, infection deeper down in the pits. So it can be a source of problem.
Genetic
inheritance is also there. Yes, it can run into families.
Dominant. Then, with variable penetration.
Yes, sir. Why should we have a look at the chin of the child who is having cleft lip and palate? Why is it important? Anybody? Yes?
To see the micrometria, so it may be one of the part of perinervous sequence.
Yes.
If that is so, then we need to be more careful during surgery, because there can be post-op respiratory distress to the child.
So not only during surgery, post-operative these patients can have more chances of their tongue falling back and they're having respiratory distress.
Yes.
And what is the importance of looking at the abnormalities in the neck? Like there could be a short, webbed neck. You know, this can be some of the syndromes which have cleft palate associated with short, webbed neck. Or there could be problems of the spine problem in the neck. So why are these things important to be noted?
These are to see the congenital anomalies, that syndromes like Down syndromes.
No, that is true. But suppose there's neck is short and the spine is having problem.
Then there will be difficult intubation.
There will be difficult intubation, and you will not be able to achieve the hyperextension of the neck, which you normally require for cleft palate repair. Yes. Now, in theory, you would definitely get some kind of question on cleft lip and palate anomalies. It could be relating to embryology, classification, and I think one of the most favorite questions you get in theory is about velopharyngeal disorder, and it could be management of velopharyngeal disorder or the various tests you conduct to come to know of this. And then there are always short notes on intravelar veloplasty, the muscles of the palate, draw a line diagram of the abnormal muscle attachments in cleft palate, and so on.
Growth factors.
And, embryogenous, it's growth factors, yes. It is also important to have an idea about the classification, especially you must all be aware of the Nagpur classification and what is the basis of this classification and how is this so simple as compared to other complicated things. Invariably when you go for your viva examination, it could be either in the form of an instruments, you are asked to choose, and most of you will end up choosing one of the mouth gags, and then it can start off questions on the various mouth gags and how to apply them. So we know that there are two main types of mouth gags, one is Dingman and other is Dots. So now person next to the red shirt, yes please, tell me which mouth gag you think is better, Dingman or Dots? You have seen Dots mouth gag or Dingman mouth gag? You have seen only the Dingman. So what is the good thing about Dingman? All good things, that's why you have only one. Okay. Anybody who can volunteer to answer this question? Yes. The cheek retractors are there in the Dingman. Okay, so what is the advantage of cheek retractor? Exposure of what?
Oral cavity.
Oral cavity, the palate you are seeing even with the dots. So what additional advantage is giving by retracting the cheek? You can put more instruments. Okay. Anybody who has seen the dots retractor? Our friend from Indonesia, have you seen the dots retractor? Mouth gag?
Sir, on the dots retractor, I think it is more curved on the sides. It is usually used by the ENT people. I have just
That is different. That is Boyle Davis.
That is the ENT people use is Boyle Davis, and this is Kalra dot.
Kalra dot.
Mouth gag. So there are differences in these two. Should not be confused.
Dots is the C
shape. Yes. So just tell me why should one be using dots? There must be some good point associated with dots mouth gag. That is why it has been used by some people. And there must be some real good points about Dingman also. That is why many people use Dingman. So, somebody has to answer these questions.
Additional advantage of Dingman is there is a suture retainer.
Have you ever seen somebody retaining the suture in those suture
Dingman
retainers?
Dingman, yes.
You have seen?
We
routinely take long sutures and put them there?
Yeah,
for
the flaps.
Yeah, no, but you know, please raise your hands who have seen the surgeon keeping long sutures.
For the flaps, the two flaps which we raised.
For two flaps, yeah. To holding that.
Yeah.
Okay, but those sutures you are going to hold on the sides. The spring is right in the
both front portion. Posterior.
Okay, so this could be one. Yes, Dr. Arun, you like to say something?
The tongue blade has a groove through which we can...
That groove can be incorporated in any tongue blade. See, I will give you the disadvantages of Dingman. It is so heavy, it has four walls, you know, it is so difficult to manage.
That is more cumbersome, you know.
More cumbersome.
More of hardware around the mouth.
Yes, why use it?
But the advantage is that it has got cheek retractors, and those cheek retractors you get a better view. The assistant also gets a better view. That is why it has become more popular. Though the design is more cumbersome. The dots mouth gag has not become more popular at this point of time just because of the reason. Though it is lighter, it also has a ligature carrier. It has an option of having a ligature carrier as well. So that's not the issue. So it's a half C and more easy to handle. But the only disadvantage is that it doesn't have somebody might have to hold the cheek and retract the cheek, especially if the patient has got a small mouth.
Dr. Mukunda, your preference on the mouth gag?
I think all of us use Dingman. Once you go, the idea is once you get used to a thing, you don't want to change because I don't see any disadvantage with Dingman. These suture carriers sometimes come in handy when you're doing something different.
Yes.
Using a pharyngeal clamp, for example, you want to take a tongue clamp, you're doing
Yes.
You want to do something extra spiritual. Having a legal career doesn't come in the way of your offer.
Absolutely. But you know, I want to bring one point to your attention, and that is, if you look at the Dingman mouth gag, it has a square frame. And if you have a patient who has group 3 cleft palate, on the lesser segment you will find that the segment is at a lower level. And then when you put this Dingman mouth gag there, you know, it will not be stable, it will be tilted. So sometimes you will find that it is difficult to manage. Although this problem has been circumvented in the new design of the Dingman. I think this is known as Miami modification, where you have this Dingman with, provided with a joint, so that you can tilt that that half of the Dingman according to adapt to the shape of the arch. I had the occasion to see this Dingman mouth gag with Dr. Adan Wallace's unit.
The Miami is basically the cranial bar. Is in two pieces.
Yes, it is in two pieces.
It's in two pieces with a joint at the lateral ends. And once you put the two hooks over the teeth, because of the unequal alveolar arches, you can tighten the, after fixing under the teeth, you can fix the joint. That was the advantage of the Miami, but it is very cumbersome. I have used that one. It's quite cumbersome to use those two bars fixing to the alveolar arches and keeping those hooks at the right place.
Yes.
So that's why it is not very popular equipment, and it is not used very often.
Yes. So ultimately it boils down to you are getting used to any set of equipment, and so please don't feel bad whether you have only one Dingman mouth gag or not mouth gag. It's getting used to it.
Another thing.
Yes.
Now they have come up with a smaller version of Dingman also. As the age of palate repair is coming, going low, they have, initially we had only one size of Dingman available.
Now nano Dingman.
Nano Dingman, yes.
Earlier we used to get tongue blades three sizes.
Yes.
Because the palate repair age was 18 months, 12 to 18 months. So we used to have three tongue blades, but now we get set with four tongue blades. The smaller one is for the infants and then three regular ones. So that is because of the younger age, the palate surgery is done around 6 months to 9 months of age. So that comes very handy, because that's the regular one, the smallest size is much bigger than the floor of the child.
Yes.
Another advantage of that cheek retractor on the both the sides, that if you are raising a myomycosal flap, buccal myomycosal flap.
It's very handy.
You take the incision, take a stay suture, and then you apply your cheek retractor. That gives you a very good counter pressure for your dissecting your myomycosal flap. So that is the advantage of having that cheek retractor like that.
And then you have, you know, sometimes you can incorporate a light source into the mouth gag. It gives you a good lighting intraorally. Now, how do you ensure that there is no pressure exerted onto the endotracheal tube by the tongue blade of the gag?
There's a groove for
Any volunteer?
There's a groove in the tongue blade for the endotracheal. There's a groove in the tongue blade for the endotracheal tube.
If you remember the groove in the tongue blade, you will find that apart from the groove, there is a slit also there in the tongue blade.
So we can.
Can you tell me why is the slit there?
We can see through the slit whether the air. It's air going column. In through the tube.
Air column will be there.
Yeah.
So you want to look at the air column or something else also you can look there, and which can give you an idea about an impending problem.
Kinking of the tube,
you don't have, you will come to know the answer.
The air is not visible.
The vapors. Mist. Yeah.
So, just go further. Instead of mist, if you start seeing something else, what could be that something else?
Bubbles.
Froth. What would that mean?
Pulmonary
edema is developing. You know, this can be a problem in some cases. So that transparent thing allows you to have a look whether this mist is fine mist only or it is some droplets coming. This should alert you that there is a impending disaster happening.
Another advantage of that opening is you see the white line in the RAE tubes. Now we use RAE tubes for cleft palate. In that, if it is not straight line vertical, if it is rotated, that means there is a twisting of the tube that need to be corrected.
but it happens very rarely because RA tube is conformed tube, it does not happen. But you can see the line of the tube as well as fogging through the transparent tube. These are the two advantages of the phone.
Anybody telling me what is the full form of RAE? So what is the advantage of this RA tube?
So it does not come in.
So it is friendly to your operative field. It doesn't interfere in your operative field.
How much do you open the mouth gap? How much do you open the mouth gap? Anyone? At what point you stop? This is another question. Just go on opening the mouth gap till you. At what time you stop? Yes. Yes. You have to ask your anesthetist whether there is any pressure.
And what is another important thing which you have to look at when you have finally, you know, tightened your mouth gag, opened up the mouth gag? Look at the tongue, yes. It should not be pressed unduly, otherwise it will turn blue.
Okay. Evolution of mouth gag, I am not talking about whole evolution, but you can go through an article about evolution of mouth gag in Cleft Palate Journal, which is open access journal, Journal of Cleft Lip, Palate and Craniofacial Anomalies, which is published in India. That is open access journal. Very good article is there in the July 2014. Similarly, there is a classification article in which the Nagpur classification has been dealt with in detail in the same issue of the journal, July 2014.
Okay, most of you must have seen that majority of the surgeons who operate upon cleft lip and palate do so by standing on the head end of the patient instead of the usual on the side or the foot end of the table. Anybody wants to tell us why should we be standing on the head end? And have you ever questioned this? That why should you stand on the head end? Your friend from Indonesia.
Maybe the access of...
You know, I will tell you, one of the famous surgeons, cleft surgeons, Dr. Philip Chen, does cleft palate surgery standing on the side of the table. He doesn't stand on the head end. So then why tell us, why majority of the people stand on the head end? Dr. Arun.
Stand means you have to sit at the head end.
Chalo sit. What is your view?
Will
you operate standing on the side of the table or you will...
No. I am used to that method and I will continue to use. Because both the sides of the cleft can be visualized well. The light is on your right upper shoulder coming into the oral cavity. So your hand is not in the way. The assistant's hand is not in the way. And you have a midline control of the things on both the sides.
But see, you do the same thing for the cleft lip also. The lighting is not very important in cleft lip.
There you are operating
from the side table.
No. There you are working on a superficial plane and there you are working in a depth.
Dr. Mukund, your comments on that?
No, for lip and nose, standing in a head end makes sense because you are constantly looking at symmetry.
Yes.
And you can assess much better sitting straight down. But the palate also, I suppose, certain amount of symmetry or you are looking at eustachian orifice, for example. I will see if I am doing a furlough.
Yes.
I would like to know where to make the cuts in the nasal layer. Mm-hmm. It helps me to see the eustachian. If I am on the side, then the opposite side would be, I have to go to the other side to look at this side. So that is why I would prefer the... I did operate on the side while trying to film what I was doing.
Yes.
Because the microscope side is coming on the head end. Then I was forced to sit. I felt very uncomfortable. standing on the side because I can't visualize, and mostly because of symmetry.
Karun.
I thought you will not ask me about
No, because, you know, I think majority of us stand on the head end. So what is our philosophy of standing on the head end?
But I feel head end is only because, means one major factor in this particular positioning is because of the training. And seeing the thing or the procedure right from your beginning of your career. I have operated standing on one side in cases where the patient was, means they had short neck and you were talking of the syndromic clefts. I have operated at least 4-5 of them. And there was no problem about operating the cleft palate with the side. But all the instrumentations are made in such a way, especially
the
Kalra dot gag, it is open on the right hand side. So it is very easy to manipulate without the bar on the right side. That's why it becomes easier to operate with right hand when you are sitting on that. Otherwise, I don't think there is much difference.
Nitin, your comment?
He said that the some of the mucopharyngeal elevators like a hockey stick, they are meant that way to stay on the back, head and hand and operate. Another thing is, better to be away from the anesthetist.
Yes. You know, I think Karun said it very correctly. It's the way we have been trained.
That's right.
But, sir, I'll just come back to you. Yeah. Let me complete. But I feel that why this trend of standing on the head end started? I think it started during the times when the anesthesia was not very good and the surgeon as well as the anesthetist wanted to be in total command of the airway. They wanted to be sure that the airway is always under their, you know, watchful eyes. You will not find any anesthetist standing on the side of the table. They will generally like to be on the head end of the table when they are intubating or they are extubating. So the visualization of the airway, you are in total control when you are at the head end. I think it started with that, and then like many rituals and conventions and plastic surgery, we got trained that way, and that's why we are doing it. And Dr. Philip Chen, when we asked him why you stand on the side, he says, I have always seen people operating standing on the side.
Yeah,
so,
Rudolph used to operate standing.
So I think it's a question of your convenience and a question of the way you have been trained. Okay.
I have a point to make.
Yes, sir.
I just started the system.
So it's already 6, sorry, it's already 6:30. You want us to continue this?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
All right.
When we started, the system was so rigid, all surgeons had to sit down. Then there used to be a trolley across the patient on which all the instruments were kept. Slowly but surely, we have gotten rid of a lot of these things. And please remember, a lot of oral surgeons and ENT surgeons operate from the side. I mean, tonsils are as deep as the uvula. So is a dental cyst at the last molar. They don't stand at the head end of the table. They stand below. So it's only a matter of habit. I don't want to give an obscene example. Everybody has a different position to do.
Right, sir. Case. Sir, we got it. Yes.
There
is midline structure in a cleft lip and cleft palate. We are using both the heads, right and left
hands. Very difficult
to use both the heads if they are standing on the side. Sir, actually, may not be strictly midline. It could be right or left also.
No,
it's not strictly not a midline,
but
it's
the
same. Okay, but see, I think we would all agree that it's a question of your training and your convictions. So let's make no bones
about it. Now, but when it comes to doing a flap, pharyngeal flap, then it is essential to
be on the head. Yes.
One cannot do a pharyngeal flap standing on the side or at the foot end at the table. It has to be at the head.
Yes, point well taken. Now, you know, you must have all seen, there could be a few exceptions where people don't pack the throat. I know of at least one example. Majority of the surgeons who pack the throat in a cleft palate operation would do this for preventing blood trickling down the trachea, or we should not be packing it at all, or we must do packing in all the cases. So anybody who wants to pick up, yes, will you like to tell us whether you should pack the throat, and if you should pack the throat, why should you do it?
So we should pack the throat in all cases, firstly because it will prevent the blood trickling down. Secondly, if there is any loose tooth, if it falls, it can get directly.
Okay,
aspirated.
Just stop here. No, why do you want the blood to, what do you say, to blood
from trickling down the
where? Trickling down where?
Sir, most of it will be swallowed. But if it is
swallowed, yes, okay, then.
But there can it can form some clots over there where after extubation the patient might regurgitate.
Okay. Now my question is, if you are not using a tube which is not curved, is there any danger of this blood going into the trachea? Yes or no?
No.
Why?
Extension.
Yes. Why? Yes, you are right. It will not go into the trachea, but why? So, because your trachea is at a higher level, so it will first pool in the nasopharyngeal area, and then it will well up to go into the trachea. So the fear of this going down into the trachea is ill-founded. Okay.
Well, some people do a different modification altogether. They put a continuous section into the nasopharynx. They don't pack it, but they put another section, continuous section into nasopharynx. So whatever blood goes there. Of course, having said that, that is the lowest portion at that point of time when the neck is extended and the head is also a little low. So unless until the blood pools to that level, it can go into trachea. But normally, yes, you don't actually need a pack. But still my advice to younger generation is, what is the harm? Do pack it.
Yes, and another important thing is that you have to realize that your tube which you are putting in the trachea is not snugly fit. And there will be some air leak. And if there is something welled up in the nasopharyngeal area, this will form bubbles, which will be very irritating and troublesome while you are operating. So I think there is a point in packing the throat. And there could be people who have the tube of their liking, which is snugly fitting into the trachea. You may choose not to pack it. But, yes sir.
There is always a chance that blood will go into the stomach. It when a blood is the greatest irritant to the gastric mucosa.
Yes.
And postoperatively, if this child vomits and brings out blood, there is so much alarm that you don't know whether it has come from the stomach or it has come from the operating area, and it's a disaster for the parents.
So consensus is we should pack it.
Yes. For the stomach rather than the trachea.
Thank you for the final.
I have stopped packing for the last 2-3 years and I have never faced any problem. And because I think pack, children are not able to tell you, but pack causes a lot of irritation. Rhinoplasty cases, I have always seen, whenever cosmetic rhinoplasty I have done, if they have done the packing, the patient complains of only that thing, nothing else.
But
when you are doing a palate and it in extended position, the blood doesn't go into the trachea, and all the time it's visible, you are doing the regular suction. So I don't think it is imperative actually to put a pack.
But I think it has to be said with a caveat that you keep on doing continuous or intermittent suction frequently in that area so that nothing goes down into the esophagus and to the stomach. Yes.
But in rhinoplasty, do always pack it. People should not go with the impression.
I mean, students should not go with the impression that in a rhinoplasty, no packs.
I always pack. But
we have had a very senior plastic surgeon had a loss of a patient because he had undertaken a rhinoplasty surgery, and the patient aspirated and the patient died. And a lot of litigation up to Supreme Court.
Actually, I always pack in rhinoplasty. The example I was giving was that causes a lot of irritation, but when you are doing palate, it's under vegan, you are doing suctions, so you can avoid it.
Okay.
Only thing is that at the end of the procedure, see to that you remove the pack.
Yes, very, very important.
Because
very, very important.
There was one incident where I operated a cleft palate, and the patient was about 7 years of age. She was in the recovery room. And he was restless. The anesthetist said, "Why are you restless? What happened?" And the patient sat up and they removed the pack himself and given it to the anesthetist.
And became restful.
The problem of this pack removal is because normally the length of the pack which is left inside is very short. Because if it is too much of length inside, it will obstruct your visibility while repairing the uvula. So one has to be very careful, and one has to demonstrate to assistant or the nurse that you have removed the pack and it should be reported. It should be specifically told by the surgeon that pack has been removed and this is kept on the trunk.
It has to be an important part of the checklist.
It is the important part of the checklist at the end of the surgery. And it has to be recorded, documented, that pack has been removed.
Can I add one more point?
Sir, Dr. Mukundan, you wanted to say something? After that, Dr. Thate.
No, I was surprised that Ravi is not using for 2-3 years. That means all the tubes are perfectly fitting it. My anesthetist forced me to put a pack, even if I don't want to in some cases. So
I put it only in a case where I'm having
leakage. Okay. Then of course I'll put it because to stop the leakage actually.
Usually the throat packing with a small gauze was initiated by the anesthetist.
Yes.
Their operations were two. One was, like stomach, blood is supposed to be a terribly irritant to the larynx.
Also. They can
most
go to
the bit, they are apprehensive about calling laryngospasm.
Yes, sir.
That's one. Second way, they are also apprehensive about my xylitine spilling into the mouth and anesthetizing the whole area, whole mucosa. And they were apprehensive that the child would aspirate. More likely to aspirate with the whole area in the throat is anesthetic. These are the two reasons why they would expect me to put it. But they specifically say don't pack it tight to avoid the pain in the throat. Just a loose pack would take care of blood trickling or the xylitine trickling.
Yes. Sir,
there is a
A well done throat pack has to be shortened when you lengthen the palate. You know, when the pack is sitting nicely in the throat and you have finished the operation, and when it comes to, like Karun said, coming to repairing the soft palate in the uvula, the test is that I am unable to do it unless I shorten the pack. So therefore I remove about half the pack, keep a little space there so that I can show the anesthetist that you have not given anesthesia and then I have actually lengthened the palate.
We all do infiltration. People could use xylocaine adrenaline or adrenaline saline solution, and majority of the people would be using the concentration of 1 in 200,000, and some would even say 1 in 400,000. So I will like to ask the students, when you are using infiltration in cleft palate, what size of the syringe should it be? Should it be 10 cc syringe, 5 cc syringe, or 2 cc syringe, or maybe 1 cc syringe? Any volunteer? Or it doesn't matter, you could use any syringe?
One of you must have seen palate
applied. So what size of syringe are you using for infiltration? Yes,
2
cc. 2 cc. Why not 10 cc? You will take 2 cc, then you will again fill it up 2-3 times. So why not straight away take 10 cc?
Sir, it is very hard to push, sir.
Very hard to push. Okay. No, we are not talking about the bevel now. We are talking of the syringe size.
It's very hard to push.
Okay.
And while pushing it, give away the syringe comes out.
The syringe, you can use lower lock in the syringe?
That is more important. Lower lock is more important
lower lock
than the size.
Okay.
Actually, it's hard to push.
You know, there are 2 points. Yeah, Dr. Arun, you wanted to say something?
Actually, the thing is, the ideal is a dental cartridge.
Yes.
That is the ideal. Unfortunately, you don't get it right now. But that is the ideal to infiltrate into the palate.
You know, when we are using infiltration in these small children who are, say, a few months of age, it is important that we don't cross the dose limit. If you are using 1 cc syringe, then chances are that you will not be infiltrating extra. If you are using 10 cc syringe, you might tend to inject more. So smaller the syringe size, lesser are the chances that you will inject more. Secondly, what should be the size of the needle by which you are injecting? So 22, 24, 26 or 20?
26.
26 for the soft palate, but for the...
Let us say we are talking about a child who is about say 1 year age or say 9 months of age.
For the soft palate, we can use 26, but for the hard palate and the for raising of the mucoperiosteal flap, we'll need a 24.
Okay, fair enough. And what should be the bevel of the needle when you are injecting? Should the bevel be facing towards the bone, or it should be facing towards the mucoperiosteal flap, the soft tissue side? I hope you get my point. Yes.
Towards the bone.
Why?
for the hydro dissection.
For the hydro dissection, yes. And secondly, if you keep the bevel towards the soft tissue side, the amount of pressure with which you are injecting can sometimes, you know, make a hole through the flap, and you know, the water can come out through that. Yes. Any comment on this discussion, Dr. Mukunda?
I think the main reason, because when you struggle, I had particularly in grown-ups,
yes,
adult, very difficult to inject and lift up the mucoperiosteum.
Yes, sir.
I've had incidents where I've
broken the syringe.
Broken a glass syringe.
Yes, sir. I think it happens with
my finger.
Once in a while with everybody.
So it's a question of how much hydrostatic pressure the tip of the needle
can withstand. Yes.
So smaller the syringe and smaller the needle, I believe you use. In practice also it's true that it's easier to inject with a smaller syringe.
Yes, sir.
That's why you choose the smallest available and then try to do with it.
In fact, I use insulin syringe. Insulin,
yes.
That's very, very useful. Insulin.
Okay.
About the dose of the dietary.
Yes.
It has to be 5 to 7 milligram per kilogram of body weight. You have to calculate according to the weight and then use that in your other infusions.
You know, we did an interesting study, our anesthetist did an interesting study in which, you know, we were conventionally using strength of 1 in 200,000. And then, so she suggested that we should use a strength of 1 in 400,000 and wait for 10 minutes. And then they recorded the various parameters, rise in BP, tachycardia, patient's pain sensation, blah, 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 all those things. And then they told us that if we add xylocaine adrenaline solution, the patient's tachycardia comes down significantly. And this must be happening because, one, because of the cardiac effect of the xylocaine. And secondly, that there is less pain happening to the patient. The more important inference from that study was that the blood loss was identical even when we use this concentration of 1 in 400,000, provided you had waited for full 10 minutes. But the systemic effects of this 1 in 400,000 was far more patient friendly than when the strength used was 1 in 200,000. So this is a case that you should use concentration which is 1 in 400,000 or so, rather than it being more concentrated.
About this fluid, there are two groups of surgeons about this fluid injection, infiltration fluid. One group uses adrenaline and xylocaine is added to the adrenaline solution. And second is, originally it is xylocaine where the adrenaline is added. These are two different things. Hope you understand that. If you use the xylocaine, custom made xylocaine with little bit adrenaline, 1 into 200,000 which is available in the bottle, you have to be very careful about using the quantity because it is very highly concentrated, 21 milligram per ml of solution. So if you have got a 5 kg child of 3 months or 4 months where you are using in lip, or 6 months palate if you do, you have got 6-7 kg, your limit is only 2 ml or 1.5 ml of that solution. That's why it is better to use little bit of xylocaine mixed to the
added to the solution of adrenaline.
So originally it should be 1 into 200 or 1 into 400,000 solution of adrenaline in which you should mix the xylocaine. And the published data is, even if it is 0.05% xylocaine, it is quite effective for the enhancement of the effect of adrenaline as well as the local analgesia in the palate of the patient.
Yes. Thank you very much for that clarification. Yes, Dr. Nitin?
I add a little amount of hyalase also that helps in the tissue dissection.
Absolutely.
One more point. Remember, surgeons being impatient, it is best to infiltrate first and then to go to wash up. Because otherwise, to infiltrate and wait there, looking here, there, I think it is doesn't suit our personality.
Sir, you must have the music running in the OT. Listen to a good song.
Yeah.
Sir, there is one more question. What
a doctor has to order for the nurse to prepare the adrenaline saline solution? Can you order the nurse? We can't.
If you order
how, how this 1 and 200,000 solution is prepared? This adrenaline saline.
You can ask some
yes.
Anybody can volunteer?
Any volunteer, how do we make this solution? Yes, Bharat.
2 MPs in 1.
Sir, we ask nurse to add 1 ml of adrenaline in 200 ml of saline. It makes, generally it comes in the concentration of 1 into 10,000. When we mix it with the 200 ml of normal saline, it makes the concentration 1 into 200,000.
It comes in concentration of 1 in 1,000.
1 in 1,000.
Yes.
1 in 1,000.
Alright. Thank you. We go to the next now. Now, you have seen and heard since morning various ways of doing muscle dissection. And one theme which was recurring again and again was that the palate needs to be lengthened. The muscles need to be put in proper position so that you can have good functional result as well as good palate lengthening. Now, so for achieving palate lengthening, how do we achieve it if you are doing a palate repair in which you have done only intravellar veloplasty, you have dissected the muscles of the nasal mucosa and then brought them in the midline, but you have not added any extra tissue or you have neither incorporated any Z plasty, will that palate lengthen or not? Anybody? Yes.
So when we have just separated the muscles from the posterior heart palate and we have sutured them in the center, uh-huh, what happens is actually they kind of pull when they are...
So they are holding the nasal mucosa anteriorly. Yeah, so once you free it, it goes back.
Yeah, it goes back on its own.
So you think that in all palate dissections where the muscle has been freed from the abnormal insertions and dissected to the posterior third of the soft palate, the palatal lengthening will invariably be there in the nasal layer. This is what you want to say? Do you all agree with this? Or you need to do something to the nasal mucosa in all cases? Nitin, what is your view?
It lengthens most of the time, and if you find that there is a tension at the nasal lining, then you just release them, create a diamond effect and put in a buccal myomucosal flap.
Yes. Dr. Karun?
That is the basically principle of now present stage of muscle dissection and closure, intravellar veloplasty or Sommerlath's radical muscle dissection, that you do not need to really truly objectively or mathematically lengthen the oral side or the nasal mucosa. Yes. You need to dissect and detach and dissect the muscles so well that it forms the sling, muscular sling in the posterior one third of the soft palate.
Yes.
And rest of the thing will be taken care of by muscle sling. It will fall in place. That's why Wau, Wardil, Kilner has went into disrepute. And it should not be used because VWK leaves a raw area in front as side. One should always prefer to close the interior as a lateral defect in all types of cleft palate, and it is possible in majority of them. So VWK fell into disrepute because of the leftover raw area, because of the pushback. So it is not required to leave raw area and push it back, because muscle sling takes care of the length of the palate. Similarly, nasal lining. Nasal lining, if you have any issue about nasal lining, dissect it well from the heart palate. It's a soft tissue. It's only mucosa. And maximum you can require is a Z-plasty only to take care of the medial band, which is basically the area of musculoskeletal. You have to just make a Z-plasty and it will lengthen. So you don't need to bother about it. Very rarely you need to incorporate soft tissue in primary cases. I'm not talking of the secondary cases.
Yes. Dr. Mukunda, your point?
No, I'm afraid to dissect it. Because the fundamental principles in plastic surgery do not differ. A straight line scar always contracts, whether it's in palate or in skin.
Mm-hmm.
The other angle is, most of the secondary cases which I see...
No, we were talking about the primary...
No, this is reverse tracking. Okay. Most of the secondary cases which I see,
yes, sir,
the pallus is short when it was a straight line closure to start with.
Right.
In my own cases, as well as in cases from all over the place.
Okay.
For these two reasons, I see no reason why you should not lengthen the palate as a routine. Because it's a fundamental principle in plastic surgery that a straight line closure, unless it is splinted, for example, in hard palate, is not going to contract because it's splinted by bone. In the soft palate, what is going to hold your muscle where you put in the posterior third of the soft palate?
I've seen Somalat put in the posterior third of the heart palate, take a stitch in front of the muscle so that the muscle doesn't go back.
Yes.
But that stitch is monocrine or in target, whatever it is.
Yes.
It is there for 2 weeks, 3 weeks. After that, the scarring is going to be there for next 3 months. What is going to prevent the scar from pulling back your muscle and getting it glued to the edge of the heart palate, which I have seen in umpteen number of cases.
Right.
So, what is wrong in putting a small Z? Why should your muscle head be so rigid to stick with this, saying that muscle is going to pull back? I don't want the muscle to pull it back. I can do it on the table. Why not?
Yes, an interesting point. Yes, Dr. Arun.
I always use Z-plasty on the nasal side. Always. Routinely. And I think somebody showed it, Dr. Ahuja showed it on the video today, that when you give a slit into it,